Hello and welcome to Rural Reflections, Colin Dave, our podcast that's co-hosted Carrington, North Dakota by my brother Dave Nelson and me, Grant Nelson, here at the studios of Thief River Falls Radio. First of all, our headlines. Bear AG officials have said they've reached an agreement with the plaintiffs to postpone a St. Louis, Missouri Roundup cancer jury trial, Wade versus Monsanto, that was to start this Friday. It was to be tried in St. Louis. This is the first multi-plaintiff trial and the first one out of California in cases involving charges that Bayer's Roundup herbicide causes cancer. So far, three California court multi-million dollar verdicts have gone against Bayer. A third tranche of market facilitation program payments could be on its way this year to U.S. farmers and ranchers affected by the trade war with China, according to Stephen Sensky, Deputy Secretary at the USDA. And finally, the widow of tax protester Gordon Call has died. Joan Call Britton was 93. In 1983, Gordon Call was a leader of the Posse Comitatus and was involved in a shootout with law enforcement near Medina, North Dakota. U.S. Marshal Kenneth Muir and Deputy Marshal Bob Cheshire were killed. Call was eventually tracked down. His son, Yori Call, along with Scott Fall, are serving life sentences for murder. And I did check them out. One of them's in Sandstone, Minnesota, and the other one's over in Illinois. So those are the headlines there, Dave. How are you doing today?
Oh, pretty good. It's a nice day. Had a frosty night. Trees are all covered in white frost, and sun is out, so it's really a very nice day today.
Well, that sounds good. We've been, you know, we've been in the clouds here for quite a while, and I don't know if it's going to change much, but honestly, the temperature is so nice, I really don't mind. You know, I was thinking about the one thing in those headlines that all three of them seem to be in common is money. First of all, a lawsuit against Bayer for Roundup, which doesn't seem like they have a whole lot of evidence that it causes cancer, but emotionally it struck a chord with people. The market facilitation, of course, even though we've signed an agreement with China for them to purchase soybeans, that's probably not going to feel that for a while, so it would be nice to have a third tranche. And then the widow of tax protester Gordon Call passing away, Joan Call Britton, you know, that all kind of bubbled up during the farm crisis back in the early 80s. It seems like all those things kind of have a lot to do with money, you know?
It seems like most any kind of situation like that, you know, it's always money. They always say if you want to find out what's going on, follow the money. It is a lot of times what's going on. It's always about the money.
It sure is. So, you know, I haven't been real heavy on projects this winter myself. Have you got anything going on out there in Carrington?
No, I've been pretty lax, actually, just trying to get the daily and the weekly things done. So, yeah, no projects, no big projects, really. I have one today. Mary's staying with her mom while she's getting better. So I'm going to clean the house up today. I've taken the Christmas tree down, and I'm going to vacuum the living room and that, and then probably not too much more than that today.
That sounds all right. Now, Dave, of course, is the service manager at Case IH there in Carrington, which is now High Plains Equipment, right?
Yeah, we're in our third month of High Plains Equipment, almost done with our third month, so things are settling in and becoming the new normal.
Yeah, you and I both had a life change November 1st. You started working for a whole different company, although you're in the same place, and I started working in radio instead of at the sheriff's office. So we've had a lot going on in the last couple months, you and I both. But are the farmers coming in and getting ready for the season yet, or are they still trying to finish last season?
They're finishing last season yet. We have, actually, just this last week again, corn started being delivered to the elevator from the field again. And I'm sure it's, you know, the weather warming up and so on that brought that on. But anyway, the dryers are running. I see steam running, coming out of most of the farms, and dryers at the elevator are running. So they're plugging away at it. They got a ways to go yet. There's a lot of corn standing out here.
You know, it's just late enough in the winter now where I'm starting to get just a little bit, I'm starting to think about maybe when I'm going to take soil samples. I mean, I realize that's months off, but I'm thinking, I wonder what I'm going to put on the pasture. I wonder if we're going to have to replant some of the pasture because we were pretty rough on it last fall because it was so wet. We just had to use the pasture as it was instead of waiting for it to freeze down. And I'm getting kind of that little bit of just that good tension inside that tells me, you know, the season's not too terribly far off.
Oh, no, it's not far off at all. I've been reminding the people at work that it's February 1st coming up here. It's time to roll. Things got to go.
Time to bring things in and let you guys check them over and get them ready for the season.
Yeah, we've been mostly working on combines and sprayers, getting sprayers winterized and ready for spring, and combines keeping them going while they're harvesting. So.
Not like in the old days when all they got was a little fuel and maybe a little grease every once in a while.
No, it takes a lot more to keep the big high-dollar things going. You know, I mean, even just software upgrades and so on, you know, big things. So.
Well, you didn't need software upgrades back on the Jerome Increase Case 830, the Case 830. And that's going to be our tractor of the week this week. The Case 830 is kind of one of those classic tractors that a lot of people have had contact with. Started in 1960 through 1969, and a lot of people used them. 66 horsepower, kind of just a good, great tractor. I think it came in standard and row crop, didn't it?
Yes, it did. Our next-door neighbor, Leroy, had a 830 standard, and it was a good tractor, good pulling tractor. It was actually a pretty big tractor, you know, for our area and so on. And it was a very reliable tractor, but the knock against the standard one was the back axle was, or the front axle was set back. So it was thought to be rough riding and that kind of thing.
Okay.
But otherwise, you could turn on a dime with it with the axle set back like that. And it was a very good tractor, actually. Fuel efficient as could be.
It was, huh?
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought
it was a four-cylinder.
Say again?
It was a four-cylinder. It was the four-cylinder version of a 1030. A 1030 had a six-cylinder, and they just cut two off. It's the same bore and stroke as a 1030, but in four-cylinder version.
Taking a look at tractor data, says it has the Case Eagle Hitch open center hydraulics, 17-gallon capacity on the hydraulics, and 1,550 PSI, so which I imagine was about typical back then for hydraulic pressure, wasn't it, Dave?
Yes, it was. Very common.
A lot of people had to have a PTO pump if they were going to run a loader tractor or anything like that on a lot of the tractors, because if you're going to start lifting round bales with it, you needed quite a bit of pounds per square inch of pressure for hydraulic pressure.
Yeah, it's funny, and now we're looking at, you know, very near 4,000 pounds is your more common pressure.
Now let's talk about that picture you put on Facebook. There's a little town when you were going out to Bismarck, you saw a little town that you took a picture of?
Actually, yeah, I've wanted to go through there many times because it has a paved road to it, and there's a very big sign that says Arena, North Dakota, right on a major highway there.
Okay.
And you can see some of it from the road, but not much. And when you get there, there's not much there anymore. But there's a church that you can see the steeple on from the road, and it looks kind of cool from a long distance away, and it's very much less impressive when you get close to it. But it's a little ghost town now. Nobody lives there anymore. There's one house that you can see has probably been lived in the last 20 years, but siding's fallen off. It had like a plastic siding on it, you know, a little more modern plastic siding and so on. And then there's some kind of a brick building yet there, but I don't know what it is. And then this old church stands out there. Elevator is there, but apart, you know, the tin coming off and so on. But it's just kind of something I had wanted to do, and I had the opportunity, and it's just a mile off the road. So I swung in and snapped a couple pictures of it while I was on my way home. It was just an especially nice morning. It was completely still and not a lot of clouds. The sun was shining real nice, and it was just a kind of fun morning, so I stopped by to take a look.
Well, it's an awful nice picture. It always makes me wonder how these towns started and why they stopped existing, you know, with people and that sort of thing. So where from Carrington is that?
It would be about 80 miles west, south and west of Carrington.
Okay.
Something like that.
And that's
80 miles south and west.
And that's Arena, North Dakota, is that right?
Yeah, yes.
Well, salute Arena. Anything else for us this week, Dave?
I guess not. I'm hoping for another nice week. It sounds like we're going to finish out January very nice, so hope it stays that way. till it warms up.
I hope so, too. All right, that'll take care of Rural Reflections. Calling Dave, your weekly podcast here from Thief River Falls Radio.